You're listening to Off the Hosel podcast presented by Rolo Golf. My name is Drew Koser. We hope you enjoy the show. Alrighty, we are back. Episode 139 presented by Rolo Golf. Yes, Off the Hosel podcast. Troy's on, Tori's on, and we got ourselves an absolute beauty. Second time guest. I saw him this summer. It was a pleasure to shake his hand. He's an unreal dude. Pete Loubardias. What's up, Pete? What's happening? Thanks for jumping to the podcast today.
Well, I'm excited to be with you because you mentioned 139. Well, July 17th of 1984 means it was 39 years ago that I started my career in a place where you, Mr. Koser, are now residing in, and that's Estevan, Saskatchewan. So I'm doing well. It is, fellas, it's been an incredibly busy, transition filled summer, but I'm good.
That's a wild story. That's kind of cool, and how that all worked out, which is pretty sweet. So
yeah, didn't know that.
Yeah, it's pretty sweet, and that's one of the questions I want to get to today, Pete. Is, you know, I have a lot of just basic questions we've had you on, but like, people, you know, the S-Van Bruins, you started here. You know, I want to go kind of even the past of where you started and then where you went to next and so on. But what were some of your favorite memories of, you know, maybe broadcasting here in S-Van, Saskatchewan?
Yeah. I mean, it's like anything else, right? It's your first. Also some other firsts that might have occurred there. Didn't go that well for me, but there was some firsts there.
Care to go further?
No, I would not.
Like first time playing Estevan Golf Course, for example.
Yeah, no, I, you know, that certainly was a first as well there too. So as usual, I get on these tirades. You know, gents, it was four of the best years of my life. I mean, I started, I was 18 years old. I didn't do the Bruins games the first year. I somehow managed to start in news, and it almost ended my career before I got started. But my dear friend Ray Morrison left. A year in, I became the voice of the Bruins the start of the 85-86 season. And Jerry James was the head coach. And I always say this to people. Jerry is one of the most unique individuals, but after all these years, I learned more from him about the game. He used to, believe it or not, allow me to sit in his office during intermissions, because we didn't do all the games in, we did like half the games,
right?
And he'd come to see me every single day. And so it was four incredible years. I was young, you had very few responsibilities. You know, I did some Big Six hockey. I remember calling the Arcola Kisby Combines and the Delisle Bruins in a senior provincial championship. You know, it was a dream come true for me. I was 7 years old when I kind of decided that I was never going to be a good enough athlete, although I was a pretty good athlete up until I was about 12 or 13, but I knew I always wanted to be a broadcaster. So Estevan's where it began, where I cut my teeth. Where I called my first games. I love softball. I think people know that. We actually started broadcasting the Estevan Men's Softball League the last 2 years I was there. I coach kids in both hockey and softball. So I have and still have friends there, the Saragellas, my good friend Tony, guy I love dearly, and the whole family. So it's a special place. It really is.
Peter, I didn't know you were a big softball guy. I am too.
Oh, are you?
Yeah. I mean, 2003 Saskatoon City Championship, I had 17 Ks, not a big deal. But
very nice.
It was not a no-hitter, though, so doesn't mean much.
Yeah, I just I just recently finished calling the Canada Cup women's event in Surrey, British Columbia. I've done that 2 years in a row. I don't know who's silly enough at my age to do 28 games at the Brick 1 week, followed by 27 softball games the next week. But yeah, I, I love that game. And, you know, being from Saskatoon, you know, that certainly back in the day, it was a huge softball hotbed. And let's put it this way. I didn't miss very many softball events of any nature from about 1979, the Canadian Junior Men's Softball Championships, right through until about 2006. So I love the game. I might I might like the game almost as much now as hockey.
I'm with you. So I'm sure you're familiar with the Masters.
Oh yes.
Yeah, I'm sure you know a bunch of them. My dad played on them, but I'm going to leave that one alone. This is about you, not my dad.
Yeah, but I may have watched your father once or twice.
Oh, I'm sure.
Oh, I did.
Pete, question for you. So I know, and you just mentioned that when you said you were 7 or 8 or 9, that you wanted to be a broadcaster. My brother, on the other hand, he was, Troy, how old are you? That you thought about going possibly to the broadcasting school. When is
42 and WABC. Pete will know what that is.
Yeah, because that's where I went. Yeah.
I actually, like I said, you're a boyhood idol. And I'm being honest with you. Listening to you growing up on Sportsline, you and Zimmer.
Sportsline.
I literally almost quit doing what I went to school for to go to the Western Academy of Broadcasting Corporation in Saskatoon. And there's days I wish I would have, and there's days I'm glad I didn't, because Pete will attest to this. When you start out in broadcasting, you start out in a small, small, small town.
Most of the time.
You don't go to the Torontos, the Ottawas, the Vancouvers, right? You start in a small town. So, tell us about that, Pete. Like, please.
Well, I mean, I could spend our whole show talking about our industry and how much it's changed, to be honest. Because the fact of the matter is, it is now different. And I feel bad for a lot of young people trying to get in the business, because there aren't as many good opportunities for young people. And frankly, I'm pull no punches. In a lot of cases, there are people that go to school, or they're from Toronto, or maybe they're from Calgary. And, you know, in a lot of ways, I think it was incredibly beneficial to start in small town and own your craft and work up a lot like players. But Troy, the one thing that is true is, and I find it more now than I did when I was, you know, really young, is I find a lot of kids now, they don't want to leave. Like, they don't want to go to Estevan. They don't want to go to North Battleford. They don't want to go to Prince Albert. And yet I can say this, I wouldn't change it for a second. And I think the one thing that's missed in our business, although it's very different, and, you know, I'm very heavily involved now in the streaming world too. So that gives young people some opportunities. But yeah, it's, when it was done in a certain way, and I'm not saying it's the right way, but you used to have to own your craft and get better. And like an athlete, after a few years, you know, were you good enough to play at the next level? And so getting to even, you know, whether it was Calgary or Edmonton or somewhere, what I would call mid-market, I mean, that was a big deal. You didn't come out of school. You didn't come out of school and end up, for the most part, in Edmonton, Calgary or Toronto or Vancouver. You need to put in some time to get
so
there.
Yeah.
To piggyback that, Pete, I'm guessing you finished school 17, 18 years old, went into broadcasting.
Mm-hmm.
How many moves? Okay, you're in Calgary right now, correct?
Well, I'm done in Calgary now. So, but yes, that's my most recent full-time gig. Yes.
Okay. So how many places have you lived from the time that you finished school to Calgary now?
Okay, so I'll try and be as quick as I can. Estevan, Saskatchewan, 4 years. Regina, Saskatchewan, 5.5 years is the voice of the Pats. A four-year stint started in TV in 93 with the better part of 4 years in Saskatoon. but spent 4 months in Regina, 3 months in Winnipeg before I went back to Saskatoon, finished there in 97, spent 3 years in Edmonton, 11 years at Sportsnet Television. The first eight were in Toronto, then to Calgary, where I have kind of, by and large, been at least professionally since 2008.
So what you're saying is you got one hell of a wife.
Well, I've had more than one, so that's and I'm way better at broadcasting or sports, at least, than I am marriage. But I think I've got it down pat this time. I think, yeah, it's. But you know what? It's funny, and I joke about it. But I say to a lot of people, and I mean it. And you know, anybody in the sports business that travels, I'm not sure this business is for anyone. Sometimes when you're on the wife side or partner side or you know, whatever whichever way you're going, because it takes an incredibly independent person. And I think especially when kids come along, these aren't easy things to do. So I've always had this, Troy, I've always said this. To be really successful in this industry, I think you have to be married to it, which doesn't always leave you a lot for the actual marriage.
It's a grind, and I'm starting that out now on the coaching side of, you know, the last 5 years. It was kind of easier because I was at home, but still traveling, and now it's kind of those 4 and 5 nights and on the road, and you know, I got a pretty good better half, you know. So I mean, I'll give her all the credit in the world. So I hope it works out all the way, but. It's a grind though. Like you're late nights and you're at the rink early and then it's late again. And it's a lot for some people. So, and it's no different than the radio world too, because you're traveling with the team. You're traveling and you're doing all the same things that the players are doing and coaches are doing. So it's a lot for sure. But that's a lot.
So can I interject there, Drew?
Sure.
No.
Just kind of segue to go into the next topic. But Pete, how the hell did you... Mm-hmm. Drew in Edmonton 6 weeks ago, not even a month ago. How did you guys
meet? Did we hook up?
I said hi, Pete. Shoot his hand.
I know, but I'm trying to segue into the Brick tournament. So
sorry. Yeah.
Oh yeah.
I know Pete. I follow Twitter, which by the way isn't. Hey, are you?
It's X now.
Yeah, it's stupid.
Yeah, anyway. I'll tell you what X is. Anyway, yeah.
I was following your tweets. I guess they're your X's while you're at the Brick tournament. Obviously following Drew, right? So how was it? How was it calling the Brick tournament? How did Drew do?
You know what?
You
know what? I know how his team did. It was, you know, what was awesome about it, Troy? And when I lived in Edmonton for 3 years in the late 90s, obviously the Brick was still going then. And people joke with me about if there was a 9-year-old competition in the backyard playing tiddlywinks, I'd probably go out, take a peek, because that's just who I am. But I don't know if it was the time in my life, and I hadn't been to it for probably 15 or 16 years, but the really neat thing, and I'd be curious about your perspective too, Drew, is it kind of took me right back to a very happy, happy place. And there's part of me that goes, this thing's pretty competitive for 10-year-olds. Okay. But the other part is, to see their joy, to see their faces, to have a chance to interact with them. They're so good, it's ridiculous. Like, I mean, I saw, I don't know how many kids, but there are legit, for sure, I think, NHLers at the event that I just called, and probably more than I think there will be even. But it's an unbelievable setting. It's a great event. And I got to tell you, it was incredibly gratifying. I enjoyed the living frickin' daylights out of it. And, you know, one of the reasons I made the transition to move away from my job with the Flames this summer is because I love amateur sports and it matters to me greatly. It always has. And I really want to spend a lot of the rest of my career giving back. And I just hope that, you know, for the parents or anybody or the kids at some point, that, you know, having somebody who's decently experienced, I think it was awesome. It was, I think, you know, we'll all watch, if you like sports, the Little League World Series coming up in Williamsport, Pennsylvania.
Boom.
Okay. To me, the brick is kind of the 10-year-old version of the Little League World Series. That's what it was. That's what it felt like. I don't think you could have a better setting than that ice palace. Kids love the living daylights out of it. Parents are a little serious for my liking at times, but that, I knew that was going to get a big smile out of the corner to my right. But it was, Troy, it was awesome. And I hope it becomes an annual event for me personally. I really enjoyed it.
Now, I think, Troy,
go ahead.
I think you nailed a lot of things there. Well, not I think, I know you did, but a Little League World Series, my wife thinks I'm crazy. Then I'm like, hey, no, like I got to watch like the Eastern final here and then yada, yada. Then I'm watching kids play baseball. But again, what you said, it takes you back to a happy time, like being a kid almost and seeing the joy on their face. Like that's so huge, I think.
Yeah, it, you know, I wish sports in its own respect, like everything else, wasn't, I wouldn't say serious, because, you know, listen, we all played, we were all ridiculously serious. But what I love the most about sports in that situation is it's not big business yet, if they can stay away from mom and dad sometimes, but, you know, it is. Like when I think about being 10, and for me personally, that was probably my best ever sports year in both hockey and baseball. It's about team. And you know, when I get a chance to talk to parents, and I think not just about the brick, but sports in general, I don't think kids are as good anymore at team. And I don't think the world's as good, guys, at team. And I think whether we're coaching them, instructing them, whatever we're doing at a certain level, especially then, it's a way to get off this. I've always said that I think sports emulates life. You win, you lose, you play on a team, you're not going to get along with everybody, you're going to love some people, you're not going to like some other people, but I've always felt that sports is one of the great teachers. I will always believe that until the day I leave the earth. And so to see kids having fun, competing their tails off, those memories will last with those kids forever.
Yeah.
They may never play some of those kids in a bigger deal. So if we get back to focusing a little bit more on what it's really about and how it can teach life lessons rather than making everybody rich and famous, I think we got something there. And again, that's part of things for me going forward. I'm not going to change it. I'm not going to change it by myself. But the only thing I can do is, and I'll say this, there's not a lot of guys who have done what I've done who are happy to go back and call 10-year-old hockey. Or 13-year-olds or 15-year-olds. But I love it.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
That is cool. Awesome. But to piggyback that, I want to ask Drew, how was your experience at the Brick Tournament? How was it as a coach? I know it was your second year. You didn't have the outcome you wanted, but how was your experience?
Yeah, I think exactly what Pete and Tori said about going back to when you were 10 and like there's times on the bench or like, you know, you see something that it's just like, it's hilarious. Cause like they do something and they're 10, you're trying not to like be too serious cause they're 10 years old and they like smile or they smirk or like sometimes they're just clueless for like that 30 seconds, but they're 10 years old. Or like after a game, like if you lose, they're upset. And then they forget about it within 25 minutes. It's where are we eating? Where's the store? Like they're 10. So that's how we all were too. And it's always a good experience, but to lose five games is obviously a toll on them at 10 years old. Like, oh no, we suck again, right? Like we're 0-5 and it sucks, but they learned valuable lessons too, though, within that. And it's, and like Pete said, they might not play ever again. And we told them that too. Like some of you guys will play, this will be your best hockey or your best sport event, and you'll never play again. Or you're going to play in the NHL or play pro or whatever it is. So it's always a good experience to be with those guys for 6 months or 4 months, whatever it is. Or no, not even that. 6 weeks, sorry. So it's a fun event. It's good for them, and they enjoy it and love being in the rink and the mall and the eye paint. And it's pretty cool. Sucks losing, though.
Probably some wicked mini stick tournaments going on in that tournament.
Dude, we got in trouble in the hotel. I was playing mini sticks too.
No shit.
I blamed it on them. Nah, it wasn't me. It was him. I'm the coach. Yeah, no, it was fun.
Is mini stick still a thing?
You know what? My team last year didn't play it, but this year's team played it. I was like, that's pretty cool.
Like it. The white plastic ones?
No, the tall mini stick ones. So my back wasn't breaking. I was like, stand up on 2 feet. It was sick. Yeah, it was nice.
Oh, you got to go classic on the knees.
Absolutely. I remember back in the day when Pete was calling Pat's games, he used to pay $3. And $3 back then was a, you know, good chunk of money.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah.
And you'd take them sticks, you put them over top of the stove, and you'd
get a little curve.
Oh, yeah.
Curve them. Oh, yeah. And then actually, Pete would remember this too, but to this day, I still have it over in my room over there. But Saskatoon Blades, I got a wooden yep. mini goal stick. You know, wow. You don't find those anymore, right? But times are different now. So
I still love the old Sherwood PMP 5030, greatest stick ever made.
Titan ASW
3000. Oh, I did not like the Titan. It was too snappy and whippy. Yeah, I was a Sherwood guy.
That's why I had 70 goals and you play defense, so.
That's a good point by you. Yeah. That's a good point. And I never played defense because I couldn't skate. So, well, I could skate. I couldn't skate well backwards.
You were wearing Douse, were you?
I had a pair once, yeah.
Wow, Douse.
But I also had, and of course, you know, we all didn't come from where they come from now, where they use $300 sticks and $800 skates. I mean, I remember the first... I remember a Christmas, I think I was 9 or 10, and I got my first pair of CCM Super Tax, which were like $88.
Yeah.
And that was like the greatest gift of all time.
Did you ever wear Cooperalls?
I didn't. I was kind of done right. I mean, I remember them very well. You know, there was a couple years in the Western League going to the Saskatoon Arena every day and every night that the Blades played, you know, where they had them. In fact, the Blades' second best ever regular season was 1982-83 when they won 52 games. And I'm still not over the fact that they lost in round one that they played in to Lethbridge. Roger Corko got hurt in game one with a separated. Anyway, Ken Reggett was too much. I can't remember the last Flames game, but I can remember every bloody minute of that six game series.
I was lucky enough to wear the Cooperalls. Mom and Dad bought them for me. I think I was about 9, 10.
Yeah.
But getting back to that series, if you would have called that, was our cousins playing? Joey?
I was watching. I wasn't quite. That was 82-83. So my career started in 84-85.
Okay.
So one of my favorite stories involving your cousin was my buddy and I used to pace around in the top corner of the old Saskatoon Arena, which is why I'm nuts, because like there's no asbestos back in that old building, which by the way is still my favorite arena of all time. So we'd pace around upstairs, standing room, top corner. And there was a guy in the Brandon Wheat Kings named Brian Wells. And Brian wasn't quite the a-hole that his brother Brad was, or Brian was. but they were not fun to deal with. And if you ever want to look up a terrible incident in the Western League, look up Brian Wells and Mark Tenorti sometime and tell me what you come up with. But anyway, it was a Sunday afternoon. I remember it like yesterday. My mom actually used to sit behind the Blades bench, and Brad Wells used to tell the Blades every single shift how he was going to come by and kick the living daylights out of them in not so nice words. So it's 6-2. There's 18 seconds left in the game. And your cousin Joey is lined up in the face-off circle in the Brandon zone. Didn't even take off his glove. Bang! Right off the draw. And all my buddy and I heard walking out of the Saskatoon arena was, could we please get a doctor to the Brandon dressing room, please?
So I forget who it was on Chicklets one time said, Joey, he punched through your head.
Oh.
But
two of the toughest guys ever. I mean, that the Clarks, and you guys are so familiar with all these people, and you know, and Joey, and you know, then add Tony Twist to the mix a little later. You know, that there's tough, and then there's those guys, and especially Twist. I remember I was living in Estevan, and I went up to Regina to watch the Blades and the Pats, and Tony Twist was in his first year in the league. I'd never seen him. I didn't really know very much about him. So Regina had a guy on their team named Bob Heaney, who was known as Bobby the Brain Heaney, and he was 20 and never met a fight he didn't like. Check his penalty minute sometime. And midway through the first period, I see this 17-year-old Tony Twist about to set up for a fight with Bob Heaney, and I'm like, oh, kid, what are you doing? Well, about 7 punches to the nose later and Heaney down like that, I'm like, well, this kid's going to be okay. This Twist guy, he's going to be all right.
Have you heard the story about their softball team?
Oh, yes.
So, like, the best part about that video is, like, it never ends. It's like Joey, Wendell, Carrie, Kevin Kaminsky, Chaser. It just, the list keeps going and going and going.
It's the other one that played for St. Louis?
Chase?
Kelly Chase?
Kelly Chase, yeah.
And then
the fact that Kelly Chase was told, what are you going to do? They've got all these guys in the fight already. Like, you're not going to help because they've got it taken care of. Like,
yeah.
It's over.
Imagine being the backup to the starters of the first five. Yeah.
Dude, imagine playing that team. Kelvington, like, no, I'm good. I'm sick that day.
Or yeah, like the real sick.
yeah, we're
not I'm in the hospital before I'm in the hospital.
Hey, Pete, I wanted to ask you a question about this. You scouted for Red Deer. Were you working for the Flames at the time while you're scouting, or how did that all unfold?
No, it happened in 2011, and I had been let go by Sportsnet Television, and scouting to this day is something that I would love to do again. So Brent Sutter was kind enough for one season to give me a bit of a helping hand going through a transition. And so I got to scout for 1 year and work my tail off. And would love to do it again. Would love to do it again. Not sure I was completely ready for it when I did it in 2011. But very confident now that it's something that I could do again and do well.
Huh, cool.
Peter, when you were in Saskatoon,
yeah,
you said you did 2 stints there. Were you with STV and... Global?
STV was Global then. It wasn't Global when I was there.
Okay, so you were still STV?
Yes.
I just remember the old
Sportsline, yeah.
Yeah, the old Sportsline and like high school football. We'd be at Boston Pizza like every Friday night watching the football highlights.
Yeah, we you know, Roger Millions has played such a massive part in my career. He hired me three different times. Roger, a one-time voice of the Saskatoon Blades, and other things, had an incredible career before he called it quits. So our whole thing, and it's funny because this could lead to a gigantic conversation about media and where it is today too. So our mandate back then was pretty simple. And remember, that was in the mid-90s. So TSN got started in 1984. Sportsnet hadn't come along as of yet. So our mandate, we had half an hour show every night, started at 11. And we wanted to show people as much local content as we possibly could. And I think we did a great job. I'm still very proud of what we did going back to those days. And there were some nights where we had 22 minutes of local content in a 24-minute show. Because I think for anybody that watched it, we covered the Blades like the NHL, we covered high school. Like, there was not anything on the the Huskies were covered like a CFL team.
I guarantee you covered me in five pin bowling. I know you guys did five pin bowling too.
We might have at some particular time. I wouldn't have said no.
That was the best part of it though.
Yeah. It was all Saskatoon stuff. And we, like I said, we took a lot of pride in it. We knew we couldn't compete in some ways with other shows, but we always thought that the people in our backyard were the most important people. And so we wanted to serve them. And I still have people come up to me, you know, when I'm back home and go, the show was good after you guys left, but, you know, it was never the same. And you know, Raj built it, and then I kind of carried on and continued with it. And now it's like nobody cares about what happens in our backyard.
I mean, like Star Phoenix going away.
Well, like all of it. Yeah, the local newspapers. There's no local sports anymore. I get it. I mean, people consume sports a lot different. I'm not... You know, the kids, they don't even watch TV, I don't think, anymore for sports. They just watch their phones.
Yeah.
One thing that I remember about Sportsline that brings me back to my childhood, and thank you, Pete. And again,
you're welcome.
I'm only like 5 years younger than you, I think. But yeah. Let's see if he knows.
352-9999. Oh, I should know.
You guys used to do a giveaway on Sportsline.
Oh, was that our number on Sportsline?
No, it was the giveaway for Mr. Bones Pizza. Wow. Just blank.
I don't
remember.
I don't remember Mr. Bones Pizza.
Yeah. Mr. Bones Pizza was a big sponsor back in the day of Sportsline. So you used to call and you got a discount anyways.
Yeah, well, I remember I remember that we certainly had sponsors, and I remember that we gave prizes away. Yeah. I remember Seafood Sam's was one of our sponsors in Saskatoon. I don't remember that, honestly. And I generally have a pretty good memory. So maybe that was post me when Mr. Bones came along.
No, you were there. You and Ron. I remember that to this day. I'll never forget it. So call in now for a free large pizza. 352-9999. Anyways, sorry.
See, that might have been in Regina, though, not Saskatoon.
Yeah, in Regina. Yes.
He's in Regina.
Yeah, right. Because I was only at Sportsline in Regina for 4 months.
You were there.
Yeah, I was. I'm sure I was.
All right. Do we need to do questions from the gallery?
Yes, we do a question from the gallery. Sponsored by Rollo Golf. Rollo Golf, we're all wearing the shirts right now. I got the Star Spangled Banners. Troy got the bananas. Tori,
I like the bananas.
He's got his flower shirt with his F-bomb hat on. Check out Rollo Golf.
That is fabulous.
Pete, check it out. We need you to do it today. Also, promo code HOSEL25. That's HOSEL25 for 25% off at checkout. Rollo Golf. get rolling all summer as you're golfing. Perfect rollerball.
Best stuff ever. I still say I want bed sheets made out of this material.
I like it.
I might never wake up.
You're styling and profiling, I can tell you that. And you guys got to get yourself one of these, too.
I love it.
Good.
I love it. So can you explain that, please?
Well, I don't know. I use the term, I don't like just people, I like good people. So I started talking about it on the radio lots and lots of years ago, and then people seemed to get a kick out of it. So they'd always bug me by saying it. So my stepdaughter a few years ago bought me this shirt that has hashtag good people on it. And I'm actually thinking about now potentially putting it out there and see if anybody, you know, it's more a Calgary oriented thing that the people there are more familiar with it. But I'm a big fan of what I like to call good people.
Peter, fun fact, I live in central Alabama and we have a brewery here called Good People Brewing.
Very nice. Great name.
So yeah, so you might want to check, like, make sure you're not stepping on them. I don't know.
Well,
I'm kidding.
You're probably right.
I highly doubt it would reach.
No. And I, you know, Alabama, they're not really too concerned about Peter Loubardias, so I can tell you that.
I doubt it.
Pete, I have a question here. It's one of my just general ones, especially for all the media and broadcasters. Your favorite memory or call? Let's go Western League, Regina Pat days.
Favorite call?
Yeah.
Frank Kovacs.
Frank Kovacs was a great one. You know what? Yeah. Probably my favorite call was a Louis Dumont shorthanded breakaway call. Easter Sunday in a second round series against the Saskatoon Blades in front of almost 7,000, which was very rare at the Agrodome. That was one of my favorite calls. The other one from the Pat standpoint that comes to mind is it was actually in 1990, the Russian World Junior team played a combination Pats and University of Regina Cougars team, and Pavel Bure and that bunch was, so that was a really neat, memorable night. Shit,
that's sick.
But yeah, that for me, the Pats didn't have a lot of success in the time that I was there, but we made it to the Eastern Division final that year before being swept by Swift. And so, I don't know if I said this on this show, but I couldn't have despised the Regina Pats more as a kid. Like, I could not stand them. And so the most ironic thing that has ever happened in my career was the guy who couldn't stand the Regina Pats ended up, his first job in the Western League was as the voice of the Regina Pats. Now, needless to say, that changed in a hurry. But I still, it still kind of makes me laugh sometimes because people say, well, are you a Pats guy or are you a Blades guy? And I say, I'm both. And I am.
I like
so, I hated the Raiders as a kid. That was my big... Couldn't stand him.
See, the funny thing is about that, Tori, is, you know, the Raiders came in 1982-83, and, you know, the Blades beat them that year, I think, 14 times.
That's it.
And then three years later, the Raiders won the Memorial Cup. So I can fully understand. And then they beat the Blades like 15 times in a row. So I completely understand, you know, why that would be the case. But in my time, you know, it was Pats and Blades, and the Pats and Blade games in the early 80s were, you know, it might not be the most skilled hockey we've ever seen, but I'll tell you what, I would take that old passion back tomorrow if I could find it, because it was frickin' incredible. And if you're a young person, I'm sorry, you have no idea. what it was like for people to actually play a sport and actually not like one another. What a concept.
Yeah.
I like Drew unfortunately doesn't know because he's too young, but I remember.
No, I remember the good years of like Kendall Campbell, Dustin Boyd, Troy Brower.
No.
Yeah,
you don't.
That's
but
a pretty good year of what do you tell me? I don't know.
No,
you know.
Okay,
no, you don't. Wade Bielak, Chris McAllister.
I'm just saying the last
year, Hordachuk.
Hold on.
You cut me off, but Lou will remember because he was up in the booth calling it. But I remember as a kid reaching over and banging on the red carpet that was around the Agardome, banging on there, banging. You don't remember that stuff. You don't remember the players that were like, it was insane, Drew. It was insane.
Okay, so I'll tell you what I do know is I remember like watching Kendall McCardo and Troy Brower and what was the Dustin Boyd? Like that era between that was like the last of it. Like it was pretty intense back then. Like there was some.
Good it was intense for sure.
Yeah,
but it was.
Drew, you were born like the same year Ryan Smith was playing for the Warriors.
Yeah, there's no way there's like young people. It's not their fault, right?
Right.
You don't know, like, with no disrespect, you don't know what intensity looks like at the highest level.
Right.
You don't. But you know what? You're in an era now where there's never been more skill. And I mean, it's what 10-year-olds can do at the highest level.
Right.
Might be what 16 and 17-year-olds used to do 20 years ago.
Yeah.
But. And I say this to everybody too. It's nothing to do with hockey. It's not one's better than the other, but it's the times.
The time, yeah.
It's society. It's not a hockey situation. Sports now is a big love-in. They all train together. They all have the same agents. Like it's just and the biggest difference. And listen, you guys are from small towns or relatively small towns. Hockey has become a rich kid's game. And if you don't have some pretty good dough, your chances of playing it are at a different level. And, you know, we talk about your relatives. Well, you know, the Western Hockey League in particular, you know what the Western Hockey League's character was? Small town, hard working farm kids.
Yep.
That's who built the Western Hockey League. And so in our day, growing up in Saskatoon, it was the farm kids who got all the extra ice growing up in Kelvington and Allen and like pick a spot anywhere.
Allen, my favorite rink ever.
Allen. I liked Allen too. I had a hat trick once in Allen. Good rink. but I liked Radisson too. Had some good nights there. But it's completely different now. And I will say this, take it for what it is. Kids back then, they knew how to work. They knew how to work. Now they're really, really good. Like they're beyond good sport. It's dumb.
Yeah. That,
what I saw 10-year-olds do too, are you kidding?
There's
but the work and the, and, but again, You think Joe Kosher and Wendell Clark ever had anything handed to them for free? Are you kidding? It's just a different time. You were battling, man. There was no freebies back then. Anyway,
I got me all fired up. That was deadly.
No, I love it. That's so awesome.
Okay, does anyone else have any more questions for Pete? That was unbelievable to finish the podcast.
I did. Who was your on STV/Global in Saskatoon, who was your favorite guy to work with?
Well, I loved Rog. You know, he meant Roger Millions meant a ton. You know,
he wasn't a co-host though, was he?
Yeah.
Okay.
He was with me in 93 when we started. I worked with, whether it was sports people, news people, behind the scenes, I worked with, you know what, for the most part, my long career has been filled with so many great people and so many great memories. And, you know, I saw Todd Ripplinger a few weeks ago at the Brick, who's a beauty unto himself, as anybody who's ever met Todd knows. You know, the best part, you know, and I mean it, you know, the best part about doing what I've done, it's the people. It is. It's, you know, you talk about your dad and growing up in softball. Well, I can tell you that whether it was watching the Saskatoon All-O-Matics or the Merchants or K&K Olsen when I was a kid, I worked. I was a bat boy with the Saskatoon Harmony Center women's team and a statistician in the early 80s. I mean, my life has been filled with incredible people. And my baseball coach growing up, if you're familiar at all with Saskatoon, is Spiro Lekas. And so Spiro has a diamond named after him in Saskatoon, right by Cairns Field.
Yeah, Lekas Field, yeah.
Yeah, well, that was my longtime baseball coach and a dad figure. And the other real dad figure for me was Bob Stainer, who you can also find in all kinds of Saskatchewan Hall of Fames. So coaching, sports, people, relationships, where it's taken me. If you told me the first day that I went and drove and it was about 106 and nobody remembered the last time it rained in Estevan in July of 1984, that I would have had the opportunity to do one trillionth of the stuff I've done in the last 39 years. And yes, there's been some shit bumps in the road. Some hard stuff too. But what a run. What a frickin' run. And it's the people. It's always the people.
That's 100% correct. And like back to the beginning of the question, basically, it seems like outside of, say, the big corporations like ESPN, like, you guys all have the same goal. You're all trying to have a good career and work together. And if you work together, you make each other better. You know? And the
I think that's what's changed in our business, though. I really do. Yeah.
No, I agree. It seems cutthroat.
I don't like our business that much anymore because it's become a popularity contest.
Yeah.
And what our business has lost is now if you have more social media clicks than somebody else, well, that means you're more important because somebody can monetize it.
I was just about to say it's all about clicks now.
It is all about clicks. But the reality is, yeah, it's about the X. And you can stick X and all of it wherever you want. But the greatest thing, like you said, about doing what I've done is outside of the odd situation, I have done nothing but work with awesome people who wanted to be a part of a team, who made you better, who sometimes you made them better. Like, that was your team.
Mm-hmm.
That's why that's like, so if you couldn't play, you know, there's nothing better in some ways than doing, you know, a hockey game where there's a crew of 45 people. And if everybody on that team, whether it's the audio guy or the replay guy or the technical director or the, like, people have no idea what it takes to put on great television. None. And the guys delivering the product, they're a small part of it. They're a big part of it. Because we put our ass on the line and every day be out in front of it. But if you ever get a chance in your life to watch and go in a television truck and watch a high-level game being produced, go take a peek.
Dude, yeah, now it's NASA.
I've only seen small scale of like the Access 7 ones, but they're pretty nuts though. Like they're intense and they're replaying. It's pretty cool.
It's unbelievable. It's a lot of work. I still love it. I still love every once in a while going in there because it's the skill sets are stupid.
P Pete.
I actually got one last question, Drew.
Okay, you better hustle because I'm on the ice stream before I get fired. I like to keep my job. So,
yeah, okay, I got a barbecue steak.
Movement's not a lot of fun. Go ahead.
July 31st, Pete. July 31st. What do you got going on now, and what do you got going on for the rest of the summer going into the fall?
Did he say you have to
come? Yeah, I'll be quick because I don't want him to get fired. He's in a good place, and go Bruins, go. I'm going to call the U18 women's camp coming up in St. Catharines next week. Nice. I'm hoping to do the Canadian Senior Men's Softball Championship at the end of the month in Surrey, British Columbia. I'm going to go to Edmonton and do some hosting work on the Minto Cup. And guys, I'm not exactly sure what September is going to look like.
Okay.
Well, Pete, it's always a pleasure having you on the podcast. Second go around here. Hope we can do it again. Maybe you'll make your way down to Estevan and watch a game or two this year and shake your hand and see what's up.
Go Bruins, go.
Thanks, Pete.
Thanks, guys. Always a pleasure. Thanks for having me.
Thanks for listening to Off the Hazza Podcast. We hope you enjoyed it. Reminder, all our podcasts are on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and YouTube. Be sure to check out all our channels. Like, share, and subscribe. Thank you for listening.